hope you'll be praying about what God will have you to give to the McGuire State Missions offering. As we seek to help church planters, you need to understand that one of the fastest ways to reach people is through new starts, new church starts. And so be praying about that. Also realize you need to pray for these guys on an ongoing basis. They face a lot of challenges getting started, finding a place to meet, maybe one of those. Some of them were meeting in schoolhouses before coronavirus hit. When the coronavirus hit, they had to go find other places, and many of them had no other places to go. So they're still doing things online exclusively. That's some challenges that they're facing. So you pray for these guys that are out there seeking to start new churches. They felt God's call upon their life to do this. We as Florida Baptists have said, you know what, we're going to come alongside you, and we're going to work together and support and help and encourage you. And so your gifts and your prayers definitely do that. I'm so encouraged. Daniel got away to go to Alaska for a couple of days, came back, and it's just really encouraging. I heard him this morning. I heard him begin to say this morning, say, you all. He is learning how to be a Floridian and be a Southerner. I'm glad to see that, getting some of that Alaskan blood out of him. So here we go. Read your Bible. Turn with me to John chapter 14. John chapter 14. I'm almost confident, completely confident, that there's not a person in this room that has not heard these words before. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. That phrase, the valley of the shadow of death, literally speaks of any dark and gloomy experience of life. It literally means a deep gloom or black darkness. So any dark, gloomy experience you have in life can be considered a valley. Stop and think about it. Sickness can be a valley. Loneliness can be a valley. Depression. Failure. Divorce. Death. 2020, the whole year, has seen very, very few mountaintop experiences, at least from where I stand. But boy, it's had more than its share of valleys. Don't you think so? Everything that's been going on in our world today and in our nation. I heard somebody recently say, we're not going to fall back come November when they set the time back. We're not going to give 2020 one more hour. We're ready to get this year completely over with. While there haven't been many mountaintop experiences in a lot of valleys, that's one more reason why we need to think about what we've been thinking about these last several weeks. And that is that faith in Jesus provides relief for troubled souls. We need to hear Jesus say again and again, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. We've been asking this question over the last several weeks. That question is, how can believing in Jesus and in His words bring relief to troubled souls? In John 14, chapter that begins with, let not your heart be troubled, that very one has given us the answer to that question. And there's many answers there. First of all, faith in Jesus gives us relief because He promises, He provides, He has prepared a place for us in the Father's house. He also has made the Father known and made the Father available to us. Last week, we talked about how that He answers prayer. This morning, I want you to see that Jesus assures us who believe that we will never be alone. We're never promised an absence of valleys, but we're promised the presence of the Shepherd. And the Good Shepherd is the very one who said, let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. And He went on to say in verse 18 of chapter 14, I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. If you have your Bible, join with me. I will begin with verse 15 of chapter 14, where Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and He will give you another helper, that He may abide with you forever. The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees Him nor knows Him, but you know Him, for He dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. Let's pray together. Father, as we gather this morning in a world, in a time that seems like just one valley after the other that we find ourselves traveling through, Lord, it's good to know that we're not traveling alone, for you are with us. Help us to know the reality of your presence, and help us to understand why we can have this confidence that you have not left us alone. As we preach your word, we just pray, Father, your Spirit itself would come and be our guide, open our eyes, and translate these truths into our hearts. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. As you and I go through the valleys of life, the promise of Jesus provide us the comfort, relief, the soothing, the strength, the encouragement that we need. But it does so because of faith. Because we put our faith in Jesus, and we put our faith in what he says. We stake our lives on these things. We take God at his word. And I say that to say as somewhat of a disclaimer, but at the same time as an encouragement to those that may not believe. Because I need to say to you up front, if you don't believe, then these promises you can't claim. These are for those who believe. But the reason why I'm encouraged is because by talking about these promises, my prayer is that you're going to be motivated to open your heart to receive Jesus. And as you open your heart to receive him, these truths can become true in your life. So that you would know that Jesus has decided not to leave you as an orphan. That he himself will come to you. That you never have to be alone as you go through the valleys that you're going to go through. And maybe the valleys that you're going through right this very moment. Notice with me, first of all, that Jesus assures us who believe that we will never be alone because the Holy Spirit will abide in us forever. The Holy Spirit will abide, settle down, and take up his residence in us forever. The disciples had spent about three and a half years with Jesus. They had staked everything upon him. They were convinced he was the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. They had given up family, given up friends, abandoned all that to follow Jesus. And now Jesus had just told them prior to these words that he was going to be going away, that he was going to leave them. And they began to wonder, had they been abandoned? What were they to do? Their hearts were troubled, understandably. But in response, Jesus promised them they would never be alone. He would not leave them orphaned or fatherless or without support. Indeed, he promised that he went to the Father. He would ask the Father to send to them another helper. That's how the New King James translates it, another helper. The word translated as helper there literally means the one called alongside to help. In other translations, it may be translated as the comforter, or the counselor, or the advocate, or the encourager, or sometimes it's transliterated, the paraclete. But regardless of this, Jesus said, I'm going to have the Father send you another. And that word another means another of the same kind, which therefore by implications means that when Jesus walked on the face of this earth in those 3.5 years, he had been their helper, their comforter, their counselor, their encourager, their strength. He had done that. And now he was asking the Father to send the Holy Spirit who would pick up where Jesus had left off and helping them to know how they would be able to do the greater works that he had promised back in verse 12. The greater works that even he had done. Stop and think. Jesus had been their instructor. He had been their encourager. He had been their source of strength. He had been their helper. And now the Holy Spirit would come and do those very same things in their lives. Jesus had been with them. The Holy Spirit would come and be within them. Jesus had spoken and they had heard with their ears. The Holy Spirit would speak into their very hearts. Jesus had been with them physically for about 3.5 years. Now the Spirit would be with them spiritually, but he would be with them eternally, forever. at Pentecost, Jesus fulfilled all that promise. As the Holy Spirit was sent by the Father, and the Spirit overwhelmed them. The Spirit then empowered that first century church, those first century believers, those first century disciples. He empowered them. Jesus said, "You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, to the ends of the earth." Pentecost took place. We find it recorded in the book of Acts. If you go to your Bible and look at the title page for that chapter, for that book, you'll see that it's called the Book of the Acts of the Apostles. Someone has said, and I think they're right, it could have just as easily been called the Acts of the Holy Spirit. It might even be even more correctly called the Acts of the Holy Spirit. This is what happened when Jesus left. The Holy Spirit came and filled his disciples, and everything happened in fulfillment of what Jesus promised in verse 8, that the Holy Spirit would come upon them and fill them, and they would receive power, and they would become his witnesses. And it started off in Jerusalem, and it spread from Judea, and it went through all Samaria, until finally in chapter 28, you find Paul preaching the gospel in the city of Rome, the place of power in the world at that particular point in time. God has kept his promise. Now that promise made the first century disciples is now available to 21st century disciples. As the Holy Spirit now comes and dwells within the life of every believer. One of the sad things is that we know so little about him and so often are so unaware of his presence in our lives, and yet he's there. And he's there in power, and he's got the same power. The things that he accomplished in the first century can be accomplished in the 21st century. But we just simply need to realize that he's here. He's already here. And we don't have to ask God to send the Holy Spirit. He has come. The Holy Spirit has been involved. If you're a Christ follower, if you believe, he's been involved in your life really since before you came to Christ. Because, you see, before you came to Christ, he was the one that was working in your heart to make you aware that something was wrong and you needed a Savior. He was the one that helped you understand you were lost, that you were a sinner, but that God loved you. And he helped you understand who Jesus was and how that Jesus is indeed the way, the truth, and the life, and the only way for you to have a right relationship with God. Paul said that after you received Jesus, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit. That's an important word. If you go back to the ancient practices, if they wrote letters, they would write that on parchment and they would roll it up, and then the person who had written the letter would take a drop of candle wax and seal the letter and then put a signet ring in there, and that did two things. Number one, it kept the contents of the letter intact. So when a person reading the letter would read it, he would realize this has not been tampered with. These are the words. Listen, we're promised to the Holy Spirit that the world can't tamper with us. Not even Satan can tamper with us and take away our salvation once we receive it. But not only that, it shows our authenticity. That signet ring, that signet seal, showed that this really did come from the person that had signed the letter, and it could be trusted. In other words, it was authentic. And so the presence of the Holy Spirit in your life and in my life gives us assurance we are saved. We're real. We're authentically the children of God. Paul also in Ephesians, and not only say that we are sealed by the Holy Spirit, he says the Holy Spirit now is our guarantee. That word, the Greek, speaks about earnest money. You remember earnest money? It's the same thing as a down payment. Is that first payment made guaranteeing more would come? And the Holy Spirit is that in our lives. God has begun a work in you, Paul says to the Philippians. He's going to keep on doing that work in you until the day that he completes it. It's one of the reasons why I believe very strongly in the eternal security of the believer and the perseverance of the saints. Because of the Holy Spirit's presence in our lives, who seals us and he guarantees God's salvation going to be completed in our lives. The Holy Spirit in our lives is that which gives us the opportunity to do greater works than Jesus, because he is the one that fills us with his power to do those things. Jesus identified himself in chapter 14 of John's Gospel as the truth, and now he calls the Spirit the Spirit of truth. And in so doing, he identifies himself in the Spirit so that the Spirit can also be called not only the Spirit of truth, but also the Spirit of Christ And we also know that he's also known as the Spirit of God. It's all the same, one and the same, as we talk about the Holy Spirit there. He is the Spirit of truth, and as the Spirit of truth, he is our teacher. He reminds us of the very promises that God's Word has provided and that Jesus spoke. So all these words that Jesus spoke here, these promises about a place before the Father, about knowing God and God being available, about answered prayers, about God's eternal presence with us, the Holy Spirit guarantees those as he reminds us of those very promises that he makes. It's because of the Holy Spirit that you and I, as Christ followers, can take the Word of God and he enlightens our understanding. In other words, he is what allows us to read that, and all of a sudden that Word becomes alive in our lives. And we begin to understand what we're reading. And we also begin to understand its implications and applications for our lives. And that's the work of the Holy Spirit in us. It's the Holy Spirit who, when we allow him to control our lives, to fill us, as Paul says in his letter to the Ephesians, he enables us to live victorious lives for Jesus Christ and for his kingdom. He is the one that gives us gifts so that we now have the ability to serve God effectively. He is the one that causes his Spirit and his fruit to be born in our lives. You know, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. All those things that when you put them together look just like Jesus. So that you and I now can be Christ-like and look like Jesus because of what the Holy Spirit is doing in our lives. That's who he is. That's what he's doing. That's what Jesus promised, that he'll come and be with us so that you can have the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit, knowing that you are not alone. Someone has asked the question, why would you have a troubled heart when you have the very presence of God through his Holy Spirit abiding within you? Jesus assures us that you can have this Spirit. Jesus also assures those of us who believe that we'll never be alone because Jesus will manifest himself to us and in us. To us and in us. Look at verses 19 to 21. This is the red letters. They're all Jesus' words. He says, a little while longer, the world will see me no more, but you will see me because I live, you will live also. At that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. You have my commandments and keep them. It is he who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. This relationship has always been a relationship of love. You know, God loved us and sent his Son. Christ loved us and gave his life for us. And now he calls for us to love him. And the way we demonstrate that we love him is what? It's obedience. And Jesus says, the one who obeys me, notice he says, you'll be loved by my Father, and I will love him. And then Jesus goes on to say, and I will manifest myself to him. I will manifest my presence to him as I work in him and through him to accomplish great things. Listen, that means this, that the one who left the glories of heaven to come reside among us as a human being, in human flesh, the one who was before the beginning, in the beginning, was with God, was God, who became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory he's only gotten of the Father, the one who showed us the Father, the one who died on the cross for our sins, who rose again from the grave, who ascended to the Father, who ever lives to intercede for us, now takes up residence in us. He's in us. Paul says, Christ in you, the hope of glory. How is that the hope of glory? Listen to what Paul said, his own testimony, as he wrote to the Galatians. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I live, now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Paul says, I died to myself. I was crucified with Christ. I abandoned the throne of my life so that the rightful King and Lord could take up his residence there. And now I'm surrendered and submitted to the Lordship of Jesus, and how Jesus lives his life in and through me. The question is, how can you and I live the Christian life? And the answer is, we can't. But Jesus can. And he offers to do that, as we do like Paul. We abandon any right, any claim that this life is mine. No, I belong to Jesus. I have been bought with a price. He is my Lord. He is my Savior. He is my God. He is my King. He's in charge. I'm just simply here to let him live his life in and through me. Because he can live the Christian life. So that living victoriously is possible. If I let Jesus take control and live in me. And that's what he wants to do. You know, we ask the question, how can we possibly reach this whole world? Jesus told us to go make disciples of all people groups. Do you know that at this time there's still over 2,000 unreached people groups in the world? How on earth are we going to reach them all? Well, then Jesus said, I'm going to come and I'm going to live within you. And you're going to be my disciples and I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. In Acts, they begin to see something of what that meant. In Acts 11, verse 21, we read, in the hand of the Lord, and one translation has that paraphrased as the mighty power of God, and the hand of the Lord, or the mighty power of God, was with them, and great number believed and turned to the Lord. And the same power is available to you and me so that we can do great things because the same power of God is with us. He's with us here this morning. As we leave this place, he'll be with us. As we go about being obedient to him and doing the things that he's called us to do, he's promised that he would be with us. And so, therefore, as you face the valleys of life, as you face the challenges of life, as you seek to live for and serve the Lord Jesus Christ, to fulfill his purposes in your life, you have the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit, and you have the Lord Jesus Christ in you as he manifests himself to you and in you. You are not alone. And Jesus assures us who believe that we will never be alone because Jesus and his Father will love us and make their home in us. God is omnipresent. It just simply means God is everywhere at the same time. God is here in this place this morning. I believe that by faith because he said he'd be here. But that means that every place where people are gathering to worship, God's in that place. It also means in places where they don't even recognize God, he's there as well. Believe it or not, he's even in Washington, D.C. I know that's a far stretch, but that's what the promise is. Listen to what David wrote in Psalm 139. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. God is everywhere. God is with everyone. I believe that with all my heart. God watches over even lost people. Sometimes he delivers lost people from bad situations. God's with them, no doubt. But there's a difference between God being with someone and God making his home in someone. Because God is not at home in every human life. In the lives of those ones who first trust in Jesus, and then as Jesus said, who obey and demonstrate their love for him by obeying. Listen to Jesus in verse 23. If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him. And we will come to him and make our home with him. He who does not love me does not keep my words. The words which you hear is not mine, but the Father who sent me. In other words, if your heart is disobedient, if your heart is in rebellion against God, if you are hostile against God, God cannot and God will not make his home in your life. Doesn't mean God's not going to with you and watch over you. He still does those things. But you will not have the kind of abiding relationship that God wants to have. Because God wants to settle down and be at home with you. In chapter 14, we saw earlier in verses 2 and 3 that Jesus promised that there was a dwelling place, a home that we have in the Father's house. Because Jesus had promised that. He's prepared it. He's provided it. That same word is used here in verse 23 when Jesus says that the Father and He would come and make their home in that believer who loves Him and obeys Him. The same word. Why? Because God's desire has always been to dwell with His people. That's why God had Moses erect the tabernacle in the wilderness. You remember? In verse 29 of Exodus, beginning with verse 45, God says to Moses, "And I will dwell among the children of Israel, and I will be their God. And they shall know that I am the Lord their God, who brought them out of the land of Egypt, that I may dwell among them. I am the Lord their God." God says, I want to settle down and be at home with them. In Jesus, the Word made flesh, God tabernacled with us. That's what John tells us in the first part of his gospel. Remember, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Or the Word also means tabernacle. He settled down and made his home among us in the person of Jesus Christ. And now Jesus tells us that through the mediation of the Holy Spirit, when we trust Him, Jesus Himself will come and manifest Himself in us and be in us. And who is Jesus? He is Emmanuel, God with us, God made flesh. God is with us. When we open our hearts to receive Jesus, God comes in, and He wants to make His home in us. And all this is just merely a foretaste of what's to come. Listen to Revelation 21, 3 and 4. John writes, "And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle, or the dwelling place of God, is with men, and He will dwell with them, and they shall be His people. God Himself will be with them and be their God. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor crying, nor sorrow. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away." Charles Spurgeon has said, "A little faith will take your soul to heaven, but great faith will bring heaven to your soul." And that's what God is saying. You can have a foretaste of what heaven's going to be like, because I'm going to come and I'm going to dwell in you right here, right now, just as surely as I'm dwelling with you, will dwell with you eternally in heaven. And you and I can begin to know that right now. So what difference does that make to us right now? It makes all the difference in the world. I want to listen to the promise that God made Joshua. Moses had died. Joshua had taken over leadership, and he was going to lead the children of Israel into the promised land. And God says to Joshua, "Be strong and of good courage. Do not be afraid, nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." And what difference does that make for Joshua? It made him strong. It made him courageous. What difference does it make for you? As you and I face the valleys of our life, we can do so with strength and with courage, because we know that God Himself comes to be with us, and His presence strengthens us, it encourages us, it comforts us, it relieves our troubled souls. Matt Redman has written a song. We have sung it at least once, if not twice. I don't think we've sung it more than twice. "Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say, never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful." And the same God has promised to be with you as you go through your valleys and your challenges. He's with you through the presence of the Holy Spirit. He's with you through the presence of His dear Son, Christ Jesus, who lives in you. And He is with us, making His home in us. That means, my Christian friend, you are not alone. And it also means, my friend, if you're not yet a Christian, you don't have to be alone. because the same promises that have been made to those of us that trust Him are offered to you, but they're only received through faith in the relationship, faith in Jesus Christ, and entering that saving faith relationship. Listen, life is filled with many, many valleys that are going to trouble your soul. But trusting Christ, we have nothing to fear because He is with us always. No matter what we're going through, no matter how deep the valley, we're not alone. He's with us through the presence of His Holy Spirit. He and the Father are one, so that God the Father is with us in Christ. The triune God abides with us through our faith, love, and obedience. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. And He's promised you the same thing if you'll believe. Would you pray with me? Father, I pray this morning for that faith we need to be always conscious that You are with us. We're not alone. Through the power of through the presence of Your Spirit, through the presence of Your Son, through You Yourself abiding with us, making Your home in us, Father, remind us we're not alone. Father, may our hearts be encouraged, comforted, even strengthened with the assurance we are not alone. And Father, again, I pray for that one who has yet to open his heart to receive Christ, that maybe today, just knowing and hearing these promises of Your presence and Your strength to get through the valleys, they might turn to receive You and come to know Your presence and to be assured they never will be alone. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.